Welcome back to our sixth installment or module of the Citizens Pension Academy. Our topic is the Oak Brook Pension Modeler, a unique tool used by Oak Brook to measure the depth of the pension spending river rising higher and higher into our budget numbers. How high? How fast? Let's measure. Let's see. Up in Springfield, the headwaters of Oak Brook's public safety pension systems, some people wonder just how much water is flowing out of those springs and how deep this river gets by the time it arrives in Oak Brook. In The Wizard of Oz, Professor Marvel assured Dorothy that he never guessed about the future because he knew it exactly. You might remember in the movie he said, "Professor Marvel never guesses, he knows." Here in Oak Brook, we've gotten beyond guessing about the depth of our pension spending and what the future holds for our budget allocations of general fund revenue into our pensions, which the Illinois Constitution and the Illinois Pension Code have decreed for us with the stone solid strength of the Code of Hammurabi. This is Jerry Wolin. As I was preparing to run for office in late 2014, I met with Jerry and one other gentleman on a weekly basis for almost a year, stoking my knowledge to supplement my mere instinctive leanings and general outlook with real facts, so as not to sound too stupid at the public events and media interviews leading up to the 2015 election. Jerry Wolin was my immediate predecessor who held the Oak Brook trustee position for two terms. One thing Jerry did not know, however, was how bad Oak Brook's unfunded pension liabilities would end up between 2015 and 2040. Would it be some horrendous unpayable number? How deep was the river of constitutionally compelled spending? Would Oak Brook's biweekly payroll match pension spending supplements flood the budget beyond the point where sales tax alone could no longer contain it? Would we have to impose a hated real estate tax like all the other towns? Would the pension spending drown Paul Butler's Oak Brook as he left it to us? We worried about this together at our weekly Sunday night meetings at the Oak Brook Club because Oak Brook did not yet have its pension modeler spreadsheet to forecast the out years of our metastatic pension spending. How many years did Oak Brook have left? Jerry wanted to know and led the effort to obtain our pension modeler spreadsheet tool from our actuaries, which was delivered after I was sworn into office. Oak Brook's pension challenges are the same ones faced by local governments all over the United States. Here's a white paper discussing the systemic problems with public safety defined benefit plans everywhere. You can see it's written by a professor at the Rutgers Business School. Well, two professors, and the other professor from the University of California at Irvine. Looking at the whole country, the problem is that the $4.3 trillion held in these plans is still $4 trillion short of the money needed to pay the lifetime benefits to the 14.5 million active and 10.3 million retired police and firefighters and their spouses. Almost 30 million public employees plan to keep living off these defined benefit plans, which are no longer around in the private sector. The authors say we're at a crossroads. Will benefits be cut or will funding be increased? That may be an open question in some states. In Illinois, however, as we studied in Module 1, the only current plan is to increase funding due to the Illinois Constitution's pension ratchet clause adopted in 1970. The paper discussed something called GASB or GASB 68, a national accounting standard recently adopted to force local governments to put their unfunded pension liabilities onto the balance sheets of the towns sponsoring the underlying separate fire and police pension funds. This was very new in 2015. Prior to that, towns could whistle past the issue and pretend everything was just fine. Maybe a miracle would happen. GASB establishes generally accepted accounting principles or what we hear of as GAAP, for governmental entities, just like FASB, the FASB, establishes GAAP for private entities, particularly those regulated by the Securities and Exchange Commission, or SEC, that go public. FASB tries to support transparency and hence to limit deception in private companies so that investors are not misled. GASB tries to do the same thing to bring transparency and accurate disclosure to governmental entities so that Oak Brook Village trustees and our residents are not misled. Another way to say it is we Oak Brook trustees are not allowed to make stuff up or to misrepresent reality to our voters. Unlike, say, government planners in centrally directed socialist economies who can just pull numbers out of thin air. Here's more explanation of FASB and GASB. See, with FASB, it comes down to methods for recording inventory, payables, receivables, and other specific line items. And then there's a standard setting process that leads to an accounting standards codification. So then you jump down to GASB, and we've got the same thing. Standards for local and state governments and regulatory agencies using a modified accrual form of accounting, which has some differences from the FASB accrual or cash basis accounting. So you can read as much as you want about the actual gory details of FASB and GASB, but the point is it's a uniform accounting standard. Now GASB is related to FASB. Here's a family chart. And this is the schematic laying out how GASB and FASB are related to each other. The FAF sort of fathers them both, and it sits at the very top. It's called the Financial Accounting Foundation. It's based someplace in Connecticut, and the FAF appoints the members of FASB and GASB. And the FAF, in turn, is comprised of investors, business people, and accountants. So I had to put it together with this chart because it gets to be a lot, and it just sounds like a bunch of disconnected acronyms after a while. So let's rein in these acronyms and make them stand up straight, and you can see that FASB establishes the rules that the SEC enforces on public companies, and then GASB establishes the rules enforced by the Illinois Pension Code for Oak Brook to comply with. So back to Oak Brook. The Government Accounting Standards Board, or GASB, adopted GASB 68 way back in 2012, but they made it effective for fiscal years beginning after June 15, 2014. So Oak Brook and every other town in Illinois had to comply with GASB 68 starting in 2015. The GASB 68 disclosure numbers were not calculated for Oak Brook's 2015 year until it was over in 2016, which is why our Oak Brook pension modeler was so cool to have prior to 2016. Our pension modeler was first delivered in 2015, and it calculated 25-year pension spending and consequent unfunded liabilities based initially on the results of the January 1, 2015 actuarial valuations. So we were able to see this 1 year before our actuaries otherwise were required by GASB 68 to calculate it. And now today we can calculate it anytime we want using various assumptions that we can change or model to see the long-term implications for our budget and for our biweekly payroll match obligations. Because remember, it always comes down to our biweekly payroll match obligations. And this is the transmittal letter from Jason Franken, at the time our actuary with Foster and Foster, to our then finance director, Sharon Dangles, confirming delivery of the Oak Brook pension modeler. And you can see Oak Brook paid $10,000 for this pension modeler. So in fact, we do now know how bad the pension spending will get year by year. And then here's how the Illinois state law in our pension code incorporates and enforces GASB standards for Oak Brook's fire and police pension funds and Oak Brook's disclosure of their unfunded liabilities as a component of the Village of Oak Brook's balance sheet. And these are the two sections of the pension code, the section for the police, where it says that everything will be done in accordance with rules and procedures promulgated by the Government Accounting Standards Board, and then the same language in the firefighter section of the pension code. And here is what the pension modeler shows we have to pay. And these numbers were calculated before the recent Tier 2 changes, adding more fire and police benefits for Oak Brook to pay in connection with pension fund consolidation that was a Trojan horse for Tier 2 sweeteners, and the further Tier 2 benefit enhancement signed into law just July 9, 2021. These numbers are for the combined fire and police pension payments added by Oak Brook, in addition to what the employees contribute from their paychecks. We looked at these same numbers last month in Module 5 in the context of how actuaries calculate them. Now we can hit a keyboard and calculate them too, and see how changing assumptions will affect them up or down. Now, because the Illinois legislature just passed more sweeteners less than 2 weeks ago, these numbers will be jacked up further, and our pension modeler will be able to calculate them. But here's what the modeler does for the 2021 Fire Pension Fund. These are the key assumptions. The Village Board, remember, sets the 6.75% assumed interest factor. Like central planners everywhere, we could fake this number for a while to make things look better than they are, even with GASB 68. You can expect some towns to do exactly that. The state of Illinois does that for other defined contribution plans, defined benefit pension funds for state employees and for the teachers. Same with Chicago and its defined benefit pension funds. Oak Brook relies on the sober judgment of its trustees to keep this number realistic. You can also see the pernicious effect that payroll growth can have, since pensions are calculated with reference to an employee's pay rate. And you can see the reference to the mortality assumption, picking up what we learned in modules 4 and 5. You can see here's mortality assumption RP 2014, blue collar with MP 2020. Our finance team basically takes employee census data and assumptions from the current valuations of the fire and police pension funds and enters them into the modeler spreadsheet, which calculates projections of the future years for the plan's funded status, unfunded percentage, and alternate results of funding and contributions to either hit the 90% level required by Illinois law or the 100% level permitted by Illinois law but really required to pay it. The blue bars show 100% funding and red is 90%. And our pension modeler spreadsheet produces this visual data. Here on this graph, we see the current projection for our fire pension fund, which will eat up increasing amounts of our general fund each year between now and 2040, before dropping back down to a fully funded level with no more catch-up payments needed. This assumes that the Illinois General Assembly does not keep adding unaffordable increasing pension benefits. Based on the record, we should assume that mandated benefits will continue to increase, so these numbers will go up. The modeler will show us how much and for how long. The blue bars track 100% funding payment rates by the village trustees. You can see that going blue hit us harder in the past few years, but pays off greatly compared to skimping along at 90%, which the Illinois Pension Code allows. In the old Star Trek TV show, Captain Kirk was always asking Scotty for a damage report after taking incoming hits to the Enterprise. Here's the damage report produced by our Fire Fund pension modeler. So remember, we have a pension modeler for the Fire Fund and one for the Police Fund. So this was cranked out of the Fire Fund pension modeler. And it lines up what the contributions will need to be. Here's the column titled Contribution After Overrides. That's the number that the Village of Oak Brook must put into the Fire Pension Fund each year, broken into bi-weekly payroll match contributions as shown on item 6B of each of our Board of Trustee meeting packet agendas. This is what drives the increase in our Village Public Safety payroll. And then add the police contribution and you get the total contribution. The blue bars are the unfunded amounts of our fire pension fund if we pay it down at the full 90% or full 100% rate. You can see that full payment of the unfunded liability gets us cleared out by the end of 2040. If we only paid it down at a 90% pay rate, you can see we would still have 7.5 million to 10 million in unfunded liability carrying forward basically forever. Add in the police fund, and if you treated it the same way, fire and police would have a 20 million combined unfunded nut sitting there as of 2040. So skimping along at just 90% is trustee malpractice. You see the patient getting better only if 100% payment dosages of dollars are maintained. And again, this is what our pension model or spreadsheet allows us to calculate and create in terms of very easy to see, compelling visual data. So we have a measure of how high the pension spending river will rise. And we can see that it certainly is not done rising. We can skip the apocalyptic pronouncements about all those looming pension bills. But also, don't say we don't know or that it's up to Springfield, because we do know. In a long-running poker game sense, what the numbers are and how deep that spending river is as it runs through Oak Brook. As our innumerate representatives in the General Assembly heedlessly pour on more mandatory spending almost every year for our actuaries to puzzle out. Now we can puzzle it out too with our pension model or spreadsheet. No need to huddle around the annual actuary report like waiting for the ball to drop in a roulette wheel to settle on some final number. Now we have a longitudinal way to forecast the depth of the Illinois pension spending river that will flow through our biweekly payroll numbers to stack up on our annual budget for the next 25 years. Now we have no excuses for overspending on non-pension spending when we know that the cost of not paying 100% of our pension liabilities is catastrophic. So now it's non-pension spending that needs to be submerged or drowned in that pension spending river, because none of that other spending is protected and required by the Illinois Constitution. Tie those competing spending priorities in a sack and toss them over the side of the bridge into the Oak Brook branch of the Illinois Pension River to die a terrible spending death out of our sight. All those other competing spending programs will never grow up, never bring joy to our employees or our residential spending constituencies. Those all plunge to their budgetary deaths in the pension spending river, drowned. This is the price of keeping our fire and police employees funded through their coming disabilities, retirements, and deaths, after which their spouses must be maintained at 100% spousal rollover levels of spending. Meanwhile, this is the old Butler School shown here, now the Oak Brook Heritage Center, owned and operated by the Village of Oak Brook, where the Oak Brook Historical Society rents space for the politically determined non-market price of $1 per year. Representatives of the Historical Society come to our meetings and scold us for not spending $400,000 for a new HVAC system. But now that expense has to wait as a result of our pension spending obligations that trump it. Besides, they didn't have HVAC back when this was a school either. But wouldn't it be nice to spend $400,000 on the air conditioner? Nope. The Heritage Center HVAC goes in the bag, and the bag goes into the pension river, where it sinks out of our budget, at least for this year. Why the kitten in the bag? To illustrate the emotional difficulty of cutting spending on something everyone would rather cling to and keep. The kitten features in a story from our family when my mother was a little girl in the early 1940s, and along with two other girlfriends, was walking through a wooded area near Morton Grove and heard the sounds of what turned out to be a little kitten in severe pain, which they found crying under a bush with part of its little head torn away. They took it home to save it, or to try to save it, but were told by one of their parents to bring it back to the woods and throw it into the north branch of the Chicago River since it could not be saved. The three little girls obeyed and, stricken with grief, watched as the kitten fought for its life, trying to stay above the surface as the current pulled it down the river, into which it then sank against its brave little will. A terrible story, but fitting for what we confront. The Heritage Center HVAC has also been a fight. For the present time, it's in the bag to be sunk in the Illinois Pension River. This is the Oak Brook water system. It goes beyond the borders of Oak Brook. When water rates skyrocketed as a result of the cost of maintaining our water system, we had to see if we could keep affording the cost of fixing and replacing all of the 5 zones of our system that are outside the village boundaries of Oak Brook. The answer was no. We don't have the money to keep throwing at it, in part because we're paying those fire and police pensions. Those parts of the water system that can be sold are being sold to the highest bidder. And here's the title page to the asset purchase agreement. It's being sold because the parts of the water system still inside Oak Brook's boundaries still need to be replaced and repaired while keeping rates from going through the roof. So assets are being sold. These assets that generate unpayable expenses are under contract to sell for $12 million. That one's in the bag too. Street sweeping was privatized to stop the outflow of money formerly spent on maintaining the specialized vehicle and to transfer the employees to other duties. Quality improved and we've saved money and gotten more done with fewer people. So the pressure is on we trustees to search for innovative ways to save money, and this was one of them. In this sense, the threat of the rising pension river forces us to focus on ways to economize, not just to completely cancel things. And the pension spending river keeps rising. So we move on to the Oak Brook Polo Club, founded in 1922 and freighted with the weight of another one of Paul Butler's hobbies at which he naturally excelled among world-class competitors, but which was left to us after his family all moved away. When Paul Butler played a polo match, no one knew or cared how much money it all cost. When the village of Oak Brook tried to beat Paul Butler, however, and attempted to run polo directly, it blew a $100,000 hole in our budget each year, sometimes more than that. We turned it over to a private polo group to operate using our name with a license agreement, and now we don't lose that money. The pension flood made us smarter here too, and luckily, our private partner Jim Drury showed up just in time to save it and run it more economically. And polo has been saved. So has our former annual loss of trying to run it. Polo went into the pension river and Pine Oak Partners fished it back out. On to personnel. Oak Brook no longer has an assistant village manager. Sharon Dangles, who arranged the details for Foster and Foster to prepare our Oak Brook pension modeler, is now gone. And her position was not filled, but merged back into the village manager's position. Now our village manager is his own assistant, thanks to the rising budget waters of the Illinois pension spending river. Now let's look at non-union fire department staffing. Do you see a deputy chief? Me neither. We're also short one battalion chief and 9 non-union contract paramedics, all subordinated to and basically eliminated by union pensioned fire and police employees whose spiraling pension, disability, and retirement benefits continue to be negotiated exclusively in Springfield by their lobbyists and the Illinois General Assembly, where they continue to increase from their already very high level with each increase locked into place forever by the Illinois Constitution. How many things will we have to bag up and toss into the Oak Brook branch of the Illinois Pension River? That depends on how fast the water rises, which is a function of how much legislation the public safety unions instigate in Springfield, the fons et origo of all of this. That and the usual dismal science of calculating life expectancies, investment returns, things like pandemics and collapses in social order, all the uncertainties we deal with in order to fund the otherworldly realm of assured, defined benefit pension plans for the lifetimes of our public safety employees. Meanwhile, who's really drowning these kittens? Is it really the trustees who kill programs that compete with mandatory pension spending? Or is it the Illinois General Assembly who passes and the governor who signs the spending commands carved into the Illinois Pension Code? And who instigates that spending legislation imposed on us? The fire and police union lobbyists. So what we see here is that there are some trapped cats that the firemen won't be saving, since it is they who are throwing them in the Illinois pension river. We, the trustees, are not defunding our police. Rather, our police are defunding everything else by forcing more funding for the ever-increasing pensions. No matter how high or how fast the Illinois pension spending river rises, there's one overriding certainty: the constitutional imperative of paying the full cost of the defined benefit plans for fire and police, which are completely out of control of an Oak Brook trustee. All of which will come to roost here every 2 weeks when we enact this spending commitment with payments to each of our fire and police pension plans. Item 6B of every meeting agenda packet reflects these payments. The fire and police are already maxed out on their comparatively minor contributions to pay for the pensions, which means they pay nothing more for marginal increases in their escalating benefits, all of the marginal cost of which therefore falls solely on the village of Oak Brook, as we shave off from our general fund enough money to patch up the difference between what the fire and police employees put in, which is capped, and what is needed, which is expanding. The village match is not capped. The Illinois Constitution says that the village match can never be capped, since that would translate into a failure to pay mandated benefits, which in turn would create a diminution of what Springfield has legislated in the Illinois Pension Code. Public safety pensions are a running target, as are the exact life expectancies of our employee beneficiaries. Join us next time for a review of the history of Oak Brook pension funding levels, which I know sounds excruciatingly boring, but it's something that you'll just have to soldier through if you want to get your certificate of completion for the Oak Brook Citizens Pension Academy. I'll do my best to help you stay awake, but for now, good night. That will be Tuesday, September 7th, 2021 at 7 p.m. See you then.